of flipping rock stars. I love the moments. I love the moments. I probably have been on about 3 hours of sleep waiting for this rock star moment to happen today. Piecing out, jumping off my wife's kitchen table after she found out that I did that. I didn't do that anymore. But then we had a wonderful, wonderful planning this out. I was talking to the students that we were having lunch with today. I said, I got to leave. Got to do some prep work. Having a rock star moment are awesome. Being an educator gives us these opportunities to be rock stars, whether it's in a formal setting or whether it's in a non-formal setting. Having this opportunity to motivate, to get the whole group behind you. Could you imagine what it would have been like if teachers were treated like rock stars? When I walked in, you all just like, yeah, woo! I started throwing up the rock fingers, yeah! And they'd be like, hey, the V fingers up, and V. Anyway, welcome to AED 110. We're gonna have one awesome semester. I will tell you this, you are the largest intro ag ed course ever at the University of Kentucky. You're also one of the top five largest intro to ag ed courses in the nation right now. I think Texas A&M has to speak, they're a little bit over 100 right now in their class, but we're getting there, right? Right? It's my purpose to take over the world. So, I want to welcome all of you guys to this class. We are going to have a blast, an absolute blast. And we're going to learn while we're on our way, having a blast. There are about almost every single one of you I have talked to you in some shape or fashion. You either come to visit, or you're registering, or you've changed your major in my office, and or you've changed your major in a nearby office. But either way, it's been a pleasure going through this last year journey with you guys, and finally, we now have to be with each other. One accord, one happy family. So let's talk about our thing. We are in a major need. We're going to start right off, but let's go ahead and have class. We are in a major need for educators. Major need for educators. And I don't mean just classroom teachers. We're in a major need of educators. You don't have to take notes. I'll post this on Facebook, on Canvas, not on Facebook. We're going to have a major need for educators of influence. Need, major need. And I will also tell you this, and these gals can amen me in the back. You're not going to get anything out of my PowerPoints. They're for me, not for you. So you can write down what I wrote, and it's going to make absolutely zero sense to you. I was working on an assignment. I also have ADD, so I get off track. I'm working on my PowerPoint once, and I had a student in a library, a little bruddy-nosed little eighth grader, wanted to know, what are you working on? And I was like, well, you know, I teach class at the University of Kentucky. I'm trying to get my lesson together. And he goes, let me look at it. He's like, okay. So I looked at the eighth grader, and he looked at it, and he goes, that doesn't make any sense at all. And I said, okay, great. So now that you've given me your critique, let's move on. So the need for educators of influence. We need people to educate because it's a major issue. So let me give you a prime example. If you pass a certain Burger King in Lexington, this is what you would have saw on the road. Try our new anus steak burger. And that went on for a while. And then this is one thing that really drives me crazy. If you're driving down the interstate, you'll see these signs that say eat more chicken. They have these Holstein cows that are eating, trying to influence you to eat more chicken. Why they would care, I don't know. But for some reason, it's attractive. People are all about it. All right? It tells me that there's a need for an educator. All right? So we have poor education all across the world. I'll tell a story about when, if you watch the movie Field of Dreams, and that's probably came out before you all were ever born, but it's the whole movie where this guy has this vision, and a voice comes to him and says, if you build it, they will come. And he cuts down his cornfield and builds a baseball field there, an island. Well, if you watch the movie, he's talking to his daughter on their John Deere tractor, and he's mowing down the corn with a hay binder. If you'll look and watch closely, he doesn't have the PTO shaft turning. He's just literally just driving over the corn and just plowing it on over. And when I did some reading and research about it, they said that the people, they didn't know how to turn it on. So they just told him, just drive. And so he just drove through the middle of this person's cornfield with all these cameras, talking to his daughter about Shoeless Joe Jackson. We need educators of influence. So I put it in other reasons. One is because a lot of us acted like this when we were in school. All right? Amen. Right? Give me an amen, Ben. That was you. All right, yeah. So the other one was we have a major influence of bullying. All right? My daughter 2 days ago was called a diaper by her other one of the fourth grade boys in her preschool. And then yesterday he called her a dirty diaper. So now he and I are going to meet in the parking lot later. So bullying is becoming a big thing. We need people who have a passion for influence that doesn't have to go just into a classroom. We have to have people that can educate and influence people. So, how do we influence? If you read this book called Influencer, it'd be a good way to start, right? This New York Times bestseller says that there is one way that they discuss that you can do it. I mention this a lot to our upperclassmen. Talk less. How about that? How about that concept? Teach more by talking less. Being a person of influence. It's one wonderful approach of influence. Sometimes we feel like, well, I just got to just fill their brain. I got to give them this all this motivation, and I have to educate them with everything. When sometimes maybe you just need to listen. Now, how do we get to that point? I ask you all. How do we get to that? How do we become a major person of influence? All of you guys are in here because this is an introductory class. How do we get you guys to become more influential by listening? Now, a lot of you are in here because just like a wonderful talent show, and everybody in your family has told you, oh man, you are such a good singer, and the rest of us are going, no, you're not. And so you have to enter all those talent shows, and you sing the same song, maybe it's Daddy's Hands or something like that. But when teaching, a lot of us did it because maybe we were told we were a really good speaker. We were told we were really good with people. Or maybe we're doing it for other reasons. How do we get better at influencing by not saying anything wrong? How could we do that? Anybody? Something else.
Reaction.
Absolutely. What else?
Listening.
Thank you. Mr. Glass.
Right.
I said that right.
Right.
You said that part.
These names. All right. Mr. Glass is perfect. Listening. Our actions, absolutely. Where I was going with this. So, by just taking the time, maybe to eat a humble peel, and being able to listen. There are 43 people enrolled in this class, myself 44, 5 awesome teaching assistants in this class. That makes 48 of us in here. Trust me, if you would take the opportunity to listen to 47 people in the room, you're going to become a better person of influence. Instead of just saying, you know what, I'm just going to take all this on myself, and we're going to do this. Sort of odd about my class. Class is a little different. It's going to be unorthodox from what you're used to. Because we are not going to grade you based upon your performance compared to the person beside you. We're going to grade you based upon your performance. So, Katie gives a presentation, her farmer's market lesson that's going to be coming up in a couple weeks. She does a wonderful job. Juwan comes in and he does a fantastic job. Then we move on to another one or two that comes in, and they do just, all right. We're going to grade it based upon that performance. But then after that, we're not going to grade you based upon, well, Katie did a really good job, but I didn't. Or I did really good, and Katie didn't. How come she got a better grade than me? Well, if Katie implemented what we recommended to her, if she listened and she improved, her grade goes up. You did really good, but you implemented nothing that we recommended, so you didn't get better, your grade doesn't improve. It's all based upon your performance. So you can't sit around and go, why in the world is she getting a better grade than me when everybody in the lab knows that I'm better than her? Well, that's probably a good sign that you're not better, doing better than her. Listen, be a person of influence. Which I guess that would be your actions would be good. You're good too, right? Okay, Amelia, you're always right. So, anyway, I need to be a listener, right? So, I would highly encourage you to try to check out that book. If you're into that kind of stuff, some of you all like to hang out in fiction lane. I'm not that kind, so anyway, there we go. So here's what we need. We need a coach. And strategically, I sit for probably about an hour and a half, 2 hours during the Olympics, and I went through the roster and I placed you strategically into the lab that I thought best fit you. All right? You may go, I don't understand this and I don't know what the science is behind this. There was a method to the madness. And hopefully it will show itself, or it will show that my science is completely wrong and I need to go back and reword it. But each person was specifically placed to a person who I feel like would help you with your growth area. All right? And so we need a coach. Not only is it going to be your TA or your TA lab instructor or myself, but it's going to be the folks in this room. Trust me, I have one as well. In order for me to be a good husband, my wife definitely tells me where I need to improve upon. And so does my daughter. We have a rule at our house that we don't yell at each other. Okay? And my daughter tells me every day, Daddy, you just yelled at me. And then she gets very dramatic, which she calls dramatic. And I told her, I said, I didn't yell, I almost yelled. And she goes, Daddy, you promise you never yell at me. And so I need a coach. They definitely keep me in line. We need one as well, all right? Because what would it be like if our coach simply said, satisfactory job, Ms. Higgins, satisfactory, and then walked off? We need crucial feedback. And so therefore, if you need the hurt feelings report, this is not the place for you. I want to make sure I say that. We're in this to help people grow. And the only way that you can grow is to receive feedback. Receive crucial feedback. Not ones that say, you know what, I thought you had great voice fluctuation. What does that mean? All right? I mean, we're not singing in an opera. All right? So, yes, of course, we don't want you to be Ben Stein.
Bueller.
But there are some of you who are not as action as I am, right?
Completely fine.
It's completely fine. Some of you may be as dry as a popcorn fart. That's completely fine. We can't change that about you, all right? We can't change that about you. So we're not going to go into the silly little critiques that maybe we got in speaking contests. We don't care about voice fluctuation. We don't care about hand movements. We don't care whether you talk too fast. I tell a lot of people, we had a graduate this past year named Katie Kahn. Katie Kahn grew up in Eastern Kentucky, and she talked like this, and she talked real fast. That's why people in Eastern Kentucky talk. Depends on which part of Eastern Kentucky you're from. If you're in northern part of Eastern Kentucky, where she's from, she talks real fast. And if you're in southern Eastern Kentucky, they talk real slow. And if you're in far western Kentucky, by God, they really talk slow. You got a little bit of a southern feel talking to it. And so we're not going to sit there and we're going to critique that. Because if they're delivering, if they're a person of influence, it doesn't matter how fast they talk. It doesn't matter how the dialect is. It doesn't matter at all. We had a student this past year that was a graduate in our program named Blazin. Blazin Mijatovic. And Blazin was out of Yugoslavia. And we were at Bryan Station Middle School, and Blazin was teaching. And by the end of that day, Blazin had every one of these eighth graders calling him Dr. Dirt. They loved Blazin. It wasn't because he had the perfect hand gestures, or he had the perfect voice fluctuations, or that he was able to keep a very straight line accent. No. It was because he was passionate about what he was talking about. That's all that mattered. And then we worked on the rest. Okay? So we have to be able to find us a coach. and we have to be able to give ourselves more than satisfactory. So, although you may be giving a presentation today, the rest of your colleagues in lab will be required to give you feedback. Good, quality, strong feedback. Otherwise, how are you going to improve? And how is your grade going to improve? Right? Anyway, forget about the grade. We'll get to that. So, we deserve better, right? We deserve more than just satisfactory. We deserve a strong lot of feedback. So if you want to be the next lead sales rep for all of North America for Monsanto, you're going to need a lot of feedback in order to get to that point. If you want to be the USA Today Teacher of the Year, you're going to need a lot of feedback in order to get to that point. If you want to be the Kentucky 4-H Agent of the Year, you're going to need a lot of growth and a lot of feedback before you get to that point. And my job is to make sure that when you graduate here, you're 5 years ahead of everybody else in the country. 5 years. So, the reason is, here's what we look at education. While we've got to be rigorous, we've got to have a rigorous program. When I was growing up, we used to make fun of Polaks. That's what we call it, people from Poland. Now, there may be some folks in here who actually have Polish descent, and I apologize that we made fun of you when I was in fourth grade. But it's sort of funny, we can't really make fun of them when they score at the same rate or better than us on their own mandated assessments. Now, before you get all critical and people go, yes, but they don't test everyone. Yes, it is. And on this test that was done, they randomly selected people from all of the countries that volunteered. I think there was like 62 or 63 countries that participated. And they randomly select people from all over the thing. And they did three different tests. They did just regular standard assessments, just like your ACT type assessment. But among that, they took into consideration that some people have a learning disability, some people have, maybe they can't read, or when they took those people out, they found people who were just regular old Joes that could take this assessment. And then they looked at three things. One, they looked at how many questions you get right. All right? Second thing they looked at is how long did it take you before you just bubbled it in if you didn't know the answer? How long did it take you? And then the third thing was how far along in the exam did you get? Okay. This is what was interesting. All of the data was correlated. People who got more questions right also answered more questions, and they also took longer to answer the question. Now, here's the thing about U.S. students, U.S. Kids. We have a very high level of self-efficacy. You know what self-efficacy is? Yeah. It means I can do anything. My confidence is through the roof. In fact, you tell them they can't, they're like, by God, I can. And if you put somebody from another country beside them, oh, I can definitely do better than them. Our efficacy is through the roof. Can't beat the efficacy level of a U.S. student. All right, but our efficacy doesn't reflect our opportunity to do it. We give up quicker. In fact, the average teenage attention span is 7 seconds. All right, attention span. We got to keep moving like this. The average attention span of a goldfish, 8 seconds. All right, so we give up quickly. We give up quickly. And now that I know that, Dad, it's really hard on my daughter because I won't let her give up on anything. I'm like, no, keep trying. Try those peas. All right? So, how many of the top 15 have formal systems for helping educators? So I'm just using it from a school standpoint. If you look at the major countries, Japan, China, all of these countries, they make sure before you ever go, there's a formal system of evaluation. Formal system. Meaning, you don't take on a full load of teaching. That somebody's sitting there watching, giving you thorough feedback. Now, the reason why I'm telling you that is that if it works for the top 5 countries in the world, then it should work for this small little ag ed program. And training you to either be prepared for a Fortune 500 company or being prepared for a classroom. If I'm following the same model that the top 5 countries in the world are implementing.
hopefully you follow me. Does that make sense, Eric? All right, awesome. I knew you'd just say yes and I said it. So, we have wonderful educators. In fact, you all could say that. You all have been around some phenomenal individuals who were good motivators, good deliverers of information. Some of them may have been extremely hard. Some of them may have been mean, but they were great educators. Our job, though, is to make the great better. All right? Because I believe that I have, for probably 80% of you in this room, I have tried to actually bring you into the fold, into our world, and have talked personally and excited that you joined this family. And my job is, because I want the best here. The reason is that you don't want to be in the room where you look around and you go, I'm the smartest person in the room. Now, Tyler, you may like that. But I myself like to be the dumbest one in the room because I'm going to learn off of all the people in the room. And we're going to have rock star moments. It may even start in the next 2 weeks. You may see someone in your group, in your lab, that gives a presentation and you're like, they just had a rock star moment. They need to jump off the table. All right? They had a rock star moment. And at that, you applaud them. You give them props. You don't sit there and go, ooh, I've got to be better than them. They're my enemy. No, we're going to take the Coach Cal approach. All right? We're all in this to make ourselves better and then in order to get a job. All right? So, we're going to improve those so it can be done. It is going to be done. It is currently being done. We had a young man last year that was just hired this month, a year ago, for Dow AgroSciences to be their sales rep for the state of Louisiana, and he hadn't even finished his senior year yet. And he's currently somewhere down in there in Louisiana, I think actually where a lot of this major storms are going on. And then all of my farm loans, I own a little farm by the way, and all of my loans are owned are being managed by one of our recent graduates who got hired by Farm Credit Services. And the thing is that we prepared them for those situations. And then this past summer, we recognized the Kentucky Career and Technical Education Association for every CTE teacher in the state of Kentucky. They just recognized their Teacher of the Year, who was one of our graduates from 3 years ago. All right? There are good things going on, but we've got to make sure that we keep maintain and challenge each other. The best in the room, right? We've got to challenge each other. So if we look at how does this work? Now, you all may be going, this is a weird first day lesson. I want you to understand the method to the science here. Where I'm going at this. What route am I taking you down? Okay? And what is going to be the end product? This. Something that my colleagues and I developed a few years ago, and this is our program. Over the next 3 to 4 years, some of you are here for three, four years, you're going to go down this path where we're going to make sure that you provide, again, thorough feedback. We're going to hold you accountable. We want you to be prideful for this degree area that you're in. And we're going to make sure that you're stuck in as many experiential scenarios as possible. As a result, we're going to focus on intellectual strategic instruction or delivery of information and a multicultural competence. That is my research area, and we're going to focus on how do you deliver this information to people who think differently than you do. And as a result, what we want out is a professional educator, a global thinker, someone who is a motivator, someone who is an innovative thinker, and someone who is a responsible citizen. If you're able to do those things, look at the person of influence you're going to be. Right? Now, it's my job. We can't just throw this silly little model up here on a PowerPoint and say, all right, that's what we're doing. Hope you get it. No, we've got to make sure you get to that. So a lot of the assignments that you've seen that you're going to be involved in just in this class alone will put you in these situations. Now, take for instance last semester, Miss Rachel back there was in one of my classes where we challenged them to put on an event. Several of you all even came to named our field day, where her class was in charge of putting the event on. Did it create innovative thinking? It had to. All right. Did it encourage them to be a synergistic motivator? Yes. When you have 400 students that are in your little contest that you're in charge of, you better be a good motivator. You had to be a very good educator and very responsible. There's a lot of responsibility that was put there. We didn't do much in the core book on that either. So, if we go to this, by the way, this is our Twitter hashtag. So anytime you're doing something or anything you like, if you're on Facebook or Twitter, throw that hashtag on there and it'll just be awesome. Birds will sing. So then we look at what are the trends. Because I'm all about what is the world telling us is employable, right? Therefore, I look at what's Fortune 500 companies, the 500 richest companies in the United States. What do they say? They want five things. Several of you have heard me say this. They want someone who is resilient, meaning that when we put you in a tough situation, you're not going to start crying. All right? Now, you may cry. It's all right. Don't think that you can't cry. That's all right. But you don't have these massive actions. When I first got here, it was, if Dr. Vincent hurt your feelings, you immediately go to the dean and tell them about it. We don't have that anymore. We have resilient students that go, you know what? I know where he's coming from. And these guys will tell you, if Dr. Epps and I are not giving you a hard time or not challenging you, it's because we've given up on you. Right? We want someone who is reliant, that can rely. Can you, when you're put in a situation, this is what Fortune 500 companies are wanting. So it's not just me putting you there, it's because this is what your employers are saying they want. They want someone who can be resilient. When you're put in a tough situation, you're not going to give up. The next thing they want is they want someone who is reliant. And reliant means that you can rely on a previous situation to get you through that. So therefore, I'm going to put you in every type of situation as possible. You may be in a presentation that Dr. Epps gives and a fight breakout that she has already fixed to occur. How are you going to handle that? Because we don't want a situation to occur where you're shocked. Right? We want it to just be, oh, I know how to do this because I can rely on something that has happened in the past. They want people who are global thinkers. All right? If any of you keep above a 3.25 GPA, you have something that I call social maturity, which means that you don't go on Facebook and just vent all your feelings, and you don't have this massive cloud of drama following you around everywhere. And you have academic maturity. And academic maturity, you all know the one kid who has a 4.0 in high school, but they took seven classes of PE. Yeah, that's not academically mature. So if you are socially mature, academically mature, and maintain a 3.25 GPA, then we're going to let you go for 2 months, your senior year, to Australia. All right? And then they want people who are creative. People can pull out a neat way of delivering this information. We're going to be very creative. I've already been thinking about a creative way. This morning I was, we've had some sickness in my family. And my father-in-law, of course, he's here. And did I roll my eyes right there? I'm sorry. So my father-in-law is here, and I'm riding with him, and he goes, and we're talking about suits. And I told him, I was like, man, I need a navy blue. My navy blue is wore out, and I need a gray. And then, Juwan, you wore gray today. So I thought, we could just trade suits, all right? I'm pretty sure though the waist is going to be stretched when you get it back from me, but we'll trade suits, all right? So that's my creative way of making this work, all right? Well, I don't have to buy a suit, but
may have to buy some stitching for you when you get them back. And the last thing is they want someone who can work with people who think, look, act differently than themselves. Let's think about this. Right now, who do you think has the better sales in the United States, Coca-Cola or Pepsi? Coca-Cola is the biggest company. Pepsi actually outsells them in the U.S. Here's the reason why. When Coca-Cola was the company in the United States, and they still are big, don't get me wrong, Pepsi said, what can we do different? And they went in and they fired their entire executive board. The CEO came in and fired their entire board. And they said, we don't reflect the people who we're selling our drinks to. So they came back and they redid their executive board to come in and make sure that they had people who represented every single group who they were selling products for. This is about the same time that Mountain Dew came out with about all these different flavors. Remember when they had the orange-looking colored one? What was that one called? Live Wire. Thank you. And then they had a red one as well. And then they had all these other different flavors that were with all their drinks. Guess what? Maybe they weren't for you. But they were selling high in other areas. And those people became loyal to Pepsi. Coca-Cola slowly diminished in sales. The reason was, and Coca-Cola decided, you know what? We will do the same thing, but we won't fire our board. We will just make sure that there is a chief of marketing for our Latino sales, and we will have a chief of marketing for African-American sales. And they never still keep up with Pepsi in the U.S. because Pepsi said, you know what? We won't just create titles. We're going to make sure that we bring in people who understand how to work with other people. I call it multicultural autonomy. It means that I can ebb and flow with this group and that group and be accepted among both. All right? We're going to do that. I'm the only person in the country that's researching that. So that's the reason why we're going to focus on it. Okay? But it just happens, luckily, that that's also what companies are wanting as well. All right? So, it's a two-way street. Two-way street. You have to desire feedback. You have to. And I realize that that is tough for some of us. It is tough. If you know Ms. Crump, though, she'll give it to you. She'll give me some feedback, right? Yeah. And she may come in a small package, but she's got a big body. All right? And so we have to desire constant feedback. We have to be willing to accept the feedback. And then we have to be able to increase the quantity and quality of our impact. We have to have minimal drama. Alright? Hunter Ann, I despise drama. Yes. And I don't mean Ashlyn drama as in car trouble, right? That stuff happens, okay? But I had a student that you would know, Ms. Thompson. I taught a high school student. I took him to Washington, D.C. And we were on our way up there, and we stayed the night in, I believe, Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. And that night while in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, the local Pizza Hut had a deal. Every large pizza you buy, you get two DVDs. And it was something stupid like Ghostbusters 3. Really dumb movies. He bought 10 pizzas that night. He spent his entire trip's money. And so he decides the next morning he's going to walk in here with all these pizzas, all right, and get on the van. And it was hot like it was today. I said, what in the world are you doing? And he goes, well, I'm taking these pizzas with me. I thought, you're not getting in this hot van with those stinky pizzas. We're going to ride all the way to Washington, D.C.
you're going to, I was like, no. He's like, well, I spent my entire trip's money over this. And I said, I don't care. You're going to have to just keep them here. So he like crammed like three of them in his mouth and threw them on the garbage can and got into the van. And then the rest of us all had to pay for his meals the rest of the trip. That was drama that we didn't need. Or, you know what? I just don't think she likes me. Who cares? All right? She may not. We don't need the drama. We need minimal drama. I will tell you that our TAs, Ms. Wright, myself, we have enough drama in our life. We don't even need yours. All right? Now, that being said, there are some of us who have drama that occurs that need attention. Okay? Maybe we have a sick family member that needs attention. That's not the drama we're talking about. So we have to get past that. It's called emerging into adulthood that we have right here. Then we have to have some trust. We have to have this free, open space in our TAs and our labs that you feel comfortable enough to provide feedback and that you feel comfortable to ask for it. So, what if you don't know where to start? You might know what this name is.
Where's Waldo?
All right, so if you're looking for where Waldo is and you're sitting there and you're lost, you're putting this presentation together and you go, I have no idea what I need to do to get better. That's where we come in. We're going to go, hey, look, wait, I pushed the wrong button. That's not what we're going to say. Oh, I'm going to say, hey, it's right over. It's on that half of the room. So now you're looking, you're like, I'm still lost. I'm still confused. And I'm going to go, it's right there. And you're going to be like, I still don't see it. And I'm going to be like, okay, it's right there. That's the kind of feedback we're going to try to do. We're going to try to make sure it's pinpoint and specific. And here's the one thing is that if we don't, then maybe Mr. Whitlock is right.